goes by the pseudonym Bo Snerdley.
It's time for the Soul of Excellence.
He is a radio host at 77 WABC here in New York.
The Rush Hour is on the air.
Rush, Rush.
Now here's Bo Snerdley on the Red Apple Podcast Network.
Welcome, my friends. Already, we are at the Tuesday edition of Bo Snerdley's Rush Hour. 800-848-9222 is how you reach us if you would like to be part of the program this afternoon. 800-848-9222. And we have a plethora of items to check off our list today. First, this programming note. Tomorrow morning at 10:06, Brian Kilmeade will interview former President Donald Trump. That is ahead of the big rally at Madison Square Garden. He will be speaking with the former president here on 77 WABC tomorrow morning, 10:06. Of course, I imagine they'll talk about the rally, the election. We are now 2 weeks in, and wow, a lot. So that's Brian Kilmeade. Make sure you set a little reminder for yourself that Brian will be on with former President Donald Trump tomorrow here on 77 WABC. 10:06 is the time you can tune in and catch that. Let's see. Spike Lee. New Yorker Spike Lee calling former President Donald Trump potentially winning back the White House a doomsday scenario. Spike Lee says it's incredulous how true Americans, whatever he means by that, can support Donald Trump. He said it will be doomsday, I think. I'm not the only one to say that this possibility could be the most important presidential election in the history of the country. How dire this is. It's not a joke. It's not funny. This is life or death. We haven't seen the same kind of energy and turnout in all corners of our neighborhoods and communities we saw when I was running, Obama said. You come up with all kind of reasons, excuses, et cetera, et cetera. Remember that. Now Spike Lee's jumping in the mix. And Spike Lee says of Obama, I got to give credit to President Obama because he's been going really hard on the brothers. Some might think too hard, but I don't think so. We got to wake up and don't go for the okie-dokie, the flim-flam. Can't do that. It's sad but true. Some of my brothers have been drinking that Kool-Aid, and I just hope they get their minds straight, get their minds right in time for this election. If they're conscious, if they're aware, there's nothing this other guy can do that's going to put us, not just black folks, but Americans in a better position going forward. Easy for you to say, Spike. When's the last time you had to worry about your electric bill? When's the last time you had to worry about paying bills? The average American that has suffered under inflation, I never hear you Democrats address that. When's the last time you had to worry about somebody breaking into your flat? When's the last time you had to live in a neighborhood surrounded by people that should not be in the country in the first place, committing all sorts of acts? Some of them, not all of them, not the majority of them, but some of them, creating crime waves in your neighborhood. When's the last time you had to deal with any of that, Spike? Before you start talking about people getting their heads right and staying on the plant, staying put as good little Democrats, obedient little Democrats. Meanwhile, the ghettoization of New York. Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez is slamming President Donald Trump. Why? Because he went to McDonald's. You've got Donald Trump putting on a little McDonald's costume because he thinks that's what people do. What? He went there to prove a point, Missy. They're not trying to empathize with us. They're making fun of us. Donald Trump's not making fun of anybody. In fact, this guy supports McDonald's and has for years. And speaking of that, while she's running her mouth about what's about this is a some fake photo op, he doesn't care about you. What's happening in the district that Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez is supposed to represent. Well, here it is. There are groups rallying around a police crackdown on prostitution in AOC's quote-unquote red light district, what it has turned into. They had a picture in the newspaper article accompanying this of about two dozen prostitutes lining up, soliciting for sex acts. Down, this is Roosevelt Avenue. Used to be able to walk Roosevelt Avenue day or night. But now you have groups of liberals like AOC. Actually, who are they protesting? They're not protesting the sex trafficking going on. They're protesting the police trying to crack down on these scenes that have turned Roosevelt Avenue looking like it's some sort of refugee camp from a war-torn scene. You've got people lined up. They don't even have tables for the stuff they're trying to sell. It's just all on the ground. It looks like it's impossible to even describe how this is not what this city used to look like. A nearly 2 mile stretch along Roosevelt Avenue in the migrant heavy neighborhoods of Elmhurst, North Corona, Jackson Heights has become known as a red light district, parts of which encompass Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez 14th District. Scantily dressed migrant prostitutes soliciting sex all hour, day or night, illegal street vendors clogging up the sidewalks to cook hot foods in the open with no licenses, of course. Other vendors selling everything from used clothes to pots and pans, tools, on the street, in many cases without even tables to put the stuff on, just laying on the sidewalk. It looks like this is a scene out of some, and some residents there are saying, this is like a third world country, what's happened. Last week, the mayor, who has his own problems, launched Operation Restore Roosevelt, trying to crack down on some of this. However, now you have the liberal protest groups. Make the Road New York, an advocacy group for illegal and legal immigrants, but basically an advocacy group for illegal immigrants. And you have Decrim New York, another group that wants to decriminalize all kind of sex work and prostitution. And another liberal group, the Red Canary Song, advocating for migrant massage workers. Want a happy ending? And sex workers. They're holding a rally to make sure that New York can stay like a third world nation inside Queens. I wonder how you people in Queens respond. Is this what you want? Is this what you want Queens to turn into? And why isn't Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, instead of running her mouth about Donald Trump's visit to McDonald's, actually trying to make sure that her district is a safe district? The McDonald's thing has them in a lather. Three, Senate Democrats are now accusing McDonald's of price gouging. They wrote a letter to the CEO. While working families are trying to make ends meet, McDonald's and its corporate counterparts have continued to grow their profits. Yeah, you have three United States senators complaining that an American corporation is making profits. Since 2020, the consumer price index has increased by 20%, but McDonald's may have increased its menu prices for certain items by substantially more. They don't even have the facts. They're just putting up a bunch of conjecture. Who are these three senators? Elizabeth Warren, Massachusetts. Bob Casey, Pennsylvania. Ron Wyden, Oregon. Now they want to accuse McDonald's of price gouging, no doubt, so that they can put a target on McDonald's if Kamala Harris wins. Kamala Harris. We had sound bites yesterday we didn't get to. I got distracted. I got distracted by the New York Times story about P. Did It and how this one's different. This story, but the big difference here is that these latest accusers are all men. And I wanted to know why that was so important to the Washington Post. So I got distracted and didn't play it. But I'm going to play some today. Let's start with this one. We titled this one on our cue sheet, Highly Cringe. Because that is, well, you'll hear why we call it Highly Cringe.
I'll tell you, and I know this is a controversial topic for many of us. Oh, I love Gen Z. Because we have Gen Zs in our lives. We have kids who are Gen Zs. It can be complicated, I know. I love Gen Z.
Really? She loves Gen Z? Well, that triggered something. Let's listen earlier, at another point in time, before she was running for president. Let's listen to Kamala Harris talk about Gen Z that she loves so much. I love Gen Z. Let's listen to old Kamala talk about Gen Z.
And it's a specific phase of life. Remember, age is more than a chronological fact. What else do we know about this population, 18 through 24? They are stupid. That is why we put them in dormitories. And they have a resident assistant. They make really bad decisions. And it's a specific...
Yeah, I love Gen Z. What do we know about Gen Z? They're really stupid. They're too stupid to be on their own in college dormitories. They make really bad decisions. James Carville's out. We have him. Oh, Maria Shriver, Kennedy. Maria Arnold preferred the maid. Was on, did the town hall with Kamala and... with Liz Cheney. And this is brief. It goes by very quick. Soundbite number 12. Woman in the audience wants to know, hey, can we ask some questions? This is, remember, a town hall. You're invited to show up to a town hall with Kamala. Ooh, a town hall. Maybe I'll get to ask Kamala a question. So as it begins, they ask Maria Shriver, quote-unquote journalist, if they, the audience, will be able to ask a question of Kamala and Liz. And this is what Maria said.
You're not, unfortunately. We have some predetermined questions, and hopefully I'll be able to ask some of the questions that might be in your head. I hope so.
No, you're not going to be able to ask Kamala a question. Are you kidding? Are you kidding me? You think we're going to take questions from you people? Why, you people might really ask a question. No, we have predetermined questions for her. We screen the questions very, very carefully to make sure that Kamala doesn't embarrass herself or embarrass us. So, no, we invited you as a photo op. We might even give you some McDonald's later, but no, you're not going to ask Kamala Harris any questions at all. I read it. We're not asking Kamala questions that are not predetermined from anybody. Stupid. You Gen Z or something. There's your town hall. These people are the ones that run around saying that democracy is threatened. Can I ask a question? No, you can't ask her any questions. They're predetermined. 1988, Phil Collins. Number one, stays here for 2 weeks. his version of Groovy Kind of Love. Song was a hit for the Mindbenders back in 1965. James Golden, Snerdley, 800-848-9222. Keep it right here.
Anytime you want to, you can turn me on to anything you want to, anytime at all. When I kiss you.
James Golden, known popularly as Bo Snerdley.
This is the Rush Hour with Bo Snerdley.
Rush.
Oh, darling.
What, Sir Paul? Diego, what's up with Sir Paul?
Sir Paul is being played on our airwaves at this moment because on this day in 1969, Sir Paul McCartney publicly denied rumors that he was dead. The most recent of many clues of his death hoax was the fact that he was the only barefoot Beatle on the newly released Abbey Road LP cover. Also, many, many clues in... there were many clues in Sergeant Pepper, the fact that he was in the back cover, that he was, you know, turned around, and that the album cover was the funeral for Paul. But the story was actually started as a prank by Fred Labor, a sports fan and arts writer for the Michigan Daily, the student paper at the University of Michigan. So this was this Michigan's fault. Blame Michigan on everything nowadays. Back to you, Bo, on this day in 1969.
And not only is Paul still alive all these years later, he is the most successful musician of our time in terms of the cash register. Paul, I think he's a billionaire. He has done very, very well. There are a few billionaires in the business these days, but Paul is certainly, in terms of a singer, songwriter, composer, the most successful composer of our lifetime. Yeah. Okay, so we have... Now, contrast to Maria Shriver, supposed journalist. Are you gonna? Can we ask questions? Now, we're not taking your questions, you peasants. I'm a Kennedy. Don't backtalk me. Arnold what? Anyway, no, you can't ask your questions. We have predetermined questions. Contrast that with Donald Trump. Goes up to a barber shop in the Bronx. Takes all kind of questions. Including this. Listen to this dialogue. Cut 7 between President Trump. This is just one. Up in the barber shop in the Bronx. It's a little bit lengthy, but we're going to play it anyway.
How's your rent done in terms of, do you own the store or is it rented?
No, it's rented.
And is the landlord a good guy? Is he okay?
Yeah, he's a good guy.
All right?
Yeah.
You cut his hair, I hope?
I mean, he comes in from time to time.
You know what? If you're as good as your father says, right, and you cut his hair great, that's very important, a barber to a guy. So he could be a wealthy landlord, but he'll give you a low rent because having a good barber is a very important thing, I can tell you.
So, Mr. President, you got a young guy right there.
That's a big thing, though.
It's a huge thing.
So how has your rent been? So where was it like 5 years ago, the rent?
I mean, the rent was significantly lower. Now it's gone up about... $1,200
It's okay. It's a big increase.
My issue was more the energy. I've been paying $2,100 since I first opened up. In the last 7 months, it shot up to $15,000.
What?
It's $15,000, and that's
you went from $2,100
to $15,000 in this establishment. Yeah.
How many heads can you take care of? That's a lot.
Crazy.
Right?
It's like
so
much
stealing
and
it was really for a lot. So from 2,100 to 15,000.
Yeah, so they.
So it is an example, though. Energy, right? So energy, when that comes down, ready? I almost hate to say because you'd be at 7,000, right? But your energy bill from January 20th, if I win, we got to win.
Yeah, this guy in the Bronx, New York. By the way, where's AOC on this? With her Green New Deal business, because that's part of the reason his bill went up, and she's worrying about keeping the prostitutes on the street of New York that are here illegally. His energy bills have gone up from $2,100 a month in his barbershop to $15,000 a month. And, by the way, he can ask a question that's not predetermined. This is what's really happening in the city. Now, CNN has briefly, we're going to do this right before we have to take our next break. Cut eight. They're talking about Kamala and the Latino vote. Let's hear it.
Kind of the jitters that are on the Democratic side is because that there is this feeling, and these polls are showing, that Kamala Harris, Vice President Harris, is underperforming with Latino voters. And I think, you know, kind of what we've already talked about is Latino voters are not monolithic, right?
What?
And there are plenty of Latino voters who are concerned about the border, may want a stronger border,
what?
May look at, you know, the rhetoric that Trump has about, you know, immigrants or people coming over and say, that's not me. I did it the right way. They didn't do it the right way. And he has an economic economic message and a pro-business message and an anti-socialism message that can resonate with some Latinos.
Yeah.
On this day in 2021, Adele returned to the UK singles chart after a 5-year absence when her single Easy on Me entered the chart at number one. She also set a new chart record with the single as it racked up 24 million streams in the UK the first week of its release, the most streams for a song in 1 week. We don't have it in the library, so I'm playing this one. I have to send you a cover of this done by a Mexican band, Bo. Remind me later. Okay. I forgot the name of the band, but it's on YouTube somewhere, and they killed it. They killed it. Back to you, Bo.
Nice. All right. Thank you, Diego. It's time for us to check in with traffic and with Kim Commando. We also, when we get back, we're going to hear from the mayor of Miami on this business of Latinos and the Trump vote. So keep it right here. Your calls are coming up. If you're on hold, stay on hold. 800-848-9222 is how you reach us. Traffic, Kim Commando, your calls, all coming up on Bo Snerdley's Rush Hour, the Tuesday edition. Keep it right here.
It's the Rush Hour with Bo Snerdley.
Goes by the pseudonym Bo Snerdley.
Rush.
Now, here's Bo Snerdley.
I love the colorful clothes. The year is 1966. And the way the sunlight plays. Brian Wilson, Mike Love came up with the track. This one. And on this day in 1966, Good Vibrations made its debut into the U.S. single charts. It went to number one the following December. So we'll be playing it again in December, at least. Beach Boys on WABC, Talk Radio 77, Bo Snerdley's Rush Hour. All right, so Maria Shriver, of course, hosted that event. There was Liz Cheney sitting there on one side, Kamala. And this is what Kamala said as she talked to reporters.
Today I am spending the day with former Congresswoman Liz Cheney. We are traveling to three states to talk with all Americans about what is at stake in this election, but doing it through the lens of a very important point, that what is at stake in this election is so fundamental.
And Chris Matthews weighed in. I haven't seen a lot of Chris Matthews lately, but he weighed in. And Chris Matthews says, if you're going to use her, this is in the Hill today, if you're going to use her, you need to repay her when you get into office. Don't just act like you're giving a little nod to a Republican. Clean up some of your act. You got problems. You don't have all the answers. You've got to have a much tougher action on the border. You have to get serious about it. Come up with a reasonable way of getting people into the country, a reasonable way to let them become citizens in time. You got to do something. You can't just say, I'm with Biden. That's not good. You can't say on inflation, it's world inflation. No one cares about the world. They want to know why their prices are going up. So I think Democrats have a lot of things to clean up, but one of the things they need to show is courage and guts. And he says Liz Cheney has courage and guts. Well, I asked my followers on Twitter, what sort of gift, how should Liz Cheney be repaid for her service to Kamala? I can't read a lot of the answers on the air. But some of them, I have my Twitter feed up now. I'm just looking through some of them. Some say, you know, she wants to be Secretary of State. The deal's already done, another person. What to give Liz Harris? Give her a makeover. That pantsuit that she's wearing straight out of the 1970s. You have many that are saying she should be given sentiments like this. An all-expense-paid trip to Gitmo. An orange suit, a prison cell, a night in bed with Jerry Nadler. Oh, my gosh. And then 30 pieces of aluminum. It just goes on and on. Other people know that she looks miserable on that stage. Oh, another person, a one-way ticket. Give Liz Cheney a one-way ticket to Caracas. So she can get a head start on what it would be like with 3 years of Kamala Harris running the country. Another person had a one-word answer. Give her immunity. That's what she should get from them. And it goes on and on. Those are the ones that I can. Some of the ones that what do you think she should get? Liz Cheney for all of her beautiful service to America. Now, before we went to the break, you had a CNN correspondent talking about the Latino vote. CNN had another segment. They brought on Miami Mayor Francis Suarez to talk about this problem for the Kamala Harris campaign. That's Cut 9, Diego. And let's check out what the mayor of Miami, the setup question from the interviewer is long, but it doesn't. I do that too sometimes, long setups. But here it is anyway, Cut 9.
I want to make sure that we acknowledge that the Latino vote across the country means so many different things in so many different places. People come from different communities. Obviously, Miami,
yeah,
you have so many Cuban Americans, etc. But I am still interested in your assessment of why Latinos as a voting bloc, we're seeing this with black voters as well, voters of color, that are not necessarily seeming to be as inclined toward the Democratic Party this time around as they have been in past election cycles. It's part of why we're seeing numbers, especially across the Sun Belt, seem to look better for Donald Trump. And I mean, you touched on some of these issues in terms of the border, but I'm curious why you think that is and how much of it has to do specifically with culture.
I think it has to do a lot with culture. I think it has to do with the fact that, you know, the Democrats have had 4 years under this administration and Hispanics don't see a record of success. They see inflation eating their paychecks and then they see rhetoric that does not motivate them. Under President Trump, he was tough on Latin American dictators like Fidel Castro's regime, Raul Castro and Miguel Díaz-Canel, and also in Venezuela as well. And that resonated with the Cuban and Venezuelan communities. I saw a statistic once where he got, I think, 75% of new arrival Cubans voted for the former president in the 2020 or the 2016 election. I can't remember which one. At the same time, you had Democrats monolithically branding Hispanics as Latinx, something that doesn't resonate with the Hispanic community, or saying, you know, that they're as unique as San Antonio tacos, which is something that, you know, the first lady said in one of her speeches in, I believe, San Antonio. So, you know, those are things that, you know, Hispanics just feel disconnected from the Democratic Party. They feel that the Democratic Party has not listened to them, has not made their lives better. And so they're looking for an alternative. And I think that's part of what you see. And then I also think that the former president has listened. He's listened better to the Hispanic community, and he's tailored his policies specifically to meet the needs, as you said, I think, very correctly, of the diverse Hispanic communities. They're not monolithic. They're not the same. Every community needs a different approach, has different priorities, and they have to be met on an individual basis.
Yeah. Now, let's move on to this issue. Let's stay on it of immigration for a minute. Representative Nicole Malliotakis, Staten Island, was on, I think, where was it? It was one of the cable news networks. Anyway, was asked about this business. And, you know, I've been critical of one of the votes that Representative Maliotakis took when the session Congress first started. But I got to tell you, she has redeemed herself in my eyes in a lot of ways, a lot of different ways. Let's just check in with Congresswoman Nicole Maliotakis.
Well, remember that this administration told everyone that these individuals coming over our border were being vetted. That is the biggest joke, because we have thousands of gang members that are taking over streets in our city. They've committed crimes, everything from murder to rape to countless number of robberies. And we need to get them deported. And I think the only person that's going to work with us to do that is President Trump. We need to stop the flow. And even right now, you see another caravan, you know, coming to the borders.
Right now.
And this administration.
Yep.
Still does absolutely nothing. They can quickly undo their 60 executive orders if they cared. So people vote for Kamala Harris. They need to understand that they are voting for millions of more people to enter our country illegally, for thousands of more members of these gangs, criminals, and people who are wreaking havoc in our cities. We need immigrants. We need immigrant workers. We need them to come here legally. And we have a long list of people. Maria, I have citizens that I represent whose relatives have been waiting patiently. They've done everything right. They follow our rules. They're getting pushed to the end of the line by this administration because they're prioritizing the Biden-Harris administration. The people have paid the drug cartels to enter our country. These individuals that you're seeing right now on your screen wreaking havoc on our streets ahead of the people who want to come here legally to work and contribute to our society. That is so wrong, and President Trump will fix it.
One last thing before we go. We're going to check in with Serpent Head. He was on PMS NBC 11. Serpent Head wants us to forget everything that's going on today. That question that Ronald Reagan asked was still resonates. Are you better off today than you were 4 years ago? Well, Serpent Head has his own answer to that. Let's check in with Serpent Head.
And, you know, the other question is, were you better off 4 years ago? Are you going to be better off in a penitentiary 4 years from now? Or
what?
Still having the right of free speech and the right of political dissent? Because that's literally what's on the ballot.
Literally?
And I suspect in 1941, I don't know if people thought they were better off than they were 4 years ago, or in 1861, what people thought. But I know this. When the Republic was threatened, people picked up arms and answered the call. Well, or, you know, when 1965, in the middle of the Civil Rights Movement, I think people decided they want to take matters in their own hands and create a better country. And that's what I hope we do here in the next 2 weeks.
Now, James Carville says something about that. You know, people picked up arms. Is old Serpent Head suggesting that it's time to pick up arms? And how come nobody's questioning old Serpent Head on that? Amazing. Birthday today. Eddie Brigati. With the Rascals, when they first emerged on the scene, they were known as the Young Rascals. Of course, this is theirs, Good Love, my favorite. And I love the Rascals, but my favorite will always be Groovin'. Always. From the People Gotta Be Free, another one. But Groovin', the Young Rascals, has to be. It's defining of the era. The Young Rascals, James Golden on WABC. Check in with the markets. Your call is coming up immediately after.
Hour is on the air. Attention Ditto Heads. Attention Bo Scouts.
Rush
on the Red Apple Podcast Network.
1966. Supremes become the first ever female group to have a number one album on the United States charts. The Supremes' A Go-Go was the album. This, the top single. This has to be a Holly and Dozier Holland song. Of course, Phil Collins did a great cover on this, too. Diana Ross and the Supremes. It's time.
James Golden, a.k.a. Bo Snerdley, presents Rapid Phones.
And Rick in New Jersey, you are up first on Rapid Phones. How are you? Hello, Rick.
Hello, James. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I hear you now.
Okay. I just wanted to assure you that I wasn't making fun of victims yesterday. I was actually making fun of the con men that crawl out of the woodwork when they hear a story that a rich celebrity is being charged and they're getting sued. They think, hey, I could say he touched me too, and I want my $20 million. And I think that happened to Michael Jackson. I think after the first charge, some of those people that lined up, maybe not all of them, but some of them probably just completely made up a story because they want the money.
And you know what? We all know that, and I think many of us suspect that's what happened in a lot of cases. And I will echo your I wasn't making fun of. Again, we had a call yesterday that thought I was making fun because of the Washington Post story that the latest people suing P. Diddit are all men. And I wasn't making fun of those men at all. I'm making fun of the Washington Post, always wagging their collective finger at society, telling us how horribly homophobic we all are. And they, but the big difference, they're all men. Really, Washington Post? Why does that matter? Okay, let's move on and head to Trenton, New Jersey, and Joe. Joe, how are you?
All right, but I'd like to ask a favor of you. I'm 70 years old, and I see a slow erosion in this country. On one of your shows a couple of months ago, you read a letter from Rush Limbaugh's father to Rush concerning the signing of the 51 signers of the Declaration of Independence and the sacrifices and losses that they went through. The favor I'm asking of you is, could you please read that letter again?
You know what? I'm going to ask Princess Di, because we also, she did that, editrix of the Limbaugh letter. There was an issue devoted to that. And I'm going to ask Princess Di maybe one day if we can just do a special on that and feature it from the Limbaugh letter version of it, because it was amazing. It was one of the amazing issues. They were all amazing of the Limbaugh letter. And I think that would be great. And I thank you for bringing that up. Wonderful. Thank you so much, Joe. Let's check in with Saul in Long Island. Saul, you're up next.
Hey, how are you, Mr. Boat? Listen, I predict a landslide for Donald Trump, and even New York. He's going to win New York also, and the happiest man alive is going to be Joe Biden. What they did to this man, as much as I don't like him, it's not fair. They humiliated him. George Clooney and Barack Obama, two homosexuals, got together and got ready with the president of the United States.
All right, let's not get into calling Barack Obama. Look, George Clooney has a beautiful wife. She happens to be a little bit of a radical, but she's gorgeous nonetheless. And we don't know. Nobody's calling Obama a homosexual. Tisk, Saul. Let's not go there. But I'm hear your prediction. I don't, in all honesty, think that Donald Trump's going to win New York State. But I do think, or California, but I do think that this election, anyway, we're getting close. I'll hold my prediction. Mike in Oceanside, you are up next. How are you?
Hey, Bo, how are you? What I want to tell you real quick is they keep saying that Trump is getting breaks all the millionaires and billionaires. But what they forget to tell the people is the reason why he does that is because they employ hundreds and thousands of people. AOC had said a while back that if you're making $100 million a year, you should pay 70%. That's $70 million. So if I have a company, $100 million coming in, and I got to pay $70 million, I got 500 people working for me, I'm going to have to lay off about 400. They don't tell them that they're the ones that pay the taxes.
Let me just tell you, when you, that last thing you said, yes, yes, yes. The wealthy in America pay the lion's share of taxes in America. Period. And it is this whole business of the rich don't pay their fair share is part of the Democrat playbook, but it is also to demonize people who are achievers. We got to go. May God bless and protect each and every single one of you, your families, your loved ones. Love and gratitude, my friends, for your being here with me and allowing me to be with you. Tomorrow, God willing, back for Bo Snerdley's Rush Hour, the Wednesday edition. Until then, I bid you adieu. Bye.